Let's begin. So the
ओके
action potential in the cardiac cell. So this is action potential that take place in the atria and ventricles, right?
Yes.
And this is the action potential that take place in SA node and AV node, right? So,
Yes.
okay. So what happened in the atria and ventricle? So this red color show that resting membrane potential, right? So this is a threshold. If threshold take place, then what happen? Upstroke takes place. This is upstroke, right? So this upstroke take place due to the influx of sodium, right?
Yes.
Influx of sodium due to the opening of voltage-gated sodium channel. Which channel? Voltage-gated sodium channel, right?
Yes.
So influx of the sodium that lead to the, okay, so influx of the sodium that lead to this upstroke and voltage, this takes place through the voltage gated sodium. So class 1 antiarrhythmic, class 1 antiarrhythmic work on inhibit this voltage gated sodium channel, right? What is the mechanism of action of class 1 antiarrhythmic?
The alpha sodium gated channels.
Inhibit the voltage gated sodium channel, right? So
Yes.
if you inhibit this voltage gated sodium channel, so this upstroke will be delayed and it move like to the right side, like this. Like this. I will discuss these graph with you, right? So we know that the mechanism of action of the class 1 antiarrhythmic is blockage of this voltage gated sodium channel. Okay. After the upstroke cause two things. One, inactivation of voltage gated
Sodium.
channel,
Sodium channel.
inactivation of voltage gated sodium channel, right? Another
Yes.
thing, this peak of this voltage cause opening of voltage gated potassium channel, voltage gated potassium channel. So this potassium channel, that is phase 1, is lead to initial repolarization, right? This yellow color shows the initial repolarization, and phase 0 is rapid upstroke due to the opening of the voltage gated sodium channel. Okay, so this phase 0 is a target of class 1 antiarrhythmic drug. But this phase 1 is not a target for any antiarrhythmic drug, right? So next
Okay.
phase is a phase 2. So what happens? So phase 2 is basically there is a plateau phase. This is a plateau phase. So this plateau phase is because of the two things. There is an influx of calcium ion, right? Influx of the calcium ion and efflux of potassium. So that this is a plateau phase, and this plateau phase take place in cardiac action potential, not take place in nerve action potential. So this is a difference in between the nerve action potential and cardiac action potential, right? Next
Okay.
phase is a phase three. So the phase three is basically due to massive efflux
Efflux
of
of
which ion?
potassium.
Potassium ion. So this phase three is a high yield again. Why it is a high yield? It is again a target of antiarrhythmic drugs. Which class of antiarrhythmic?
Class 3.
Class three, potassium channel blocker. So phase three is inhibited by class three antiarrhythmic, right?
Yes.
And last phase is phase four. So phase four is basically due to the high permeability through the potassium channel. Okay. So this graph is important because in US family, they love to ask questions on the basis of this kind of the graph. They give you the scenario, give the side effect. For example, they give you the side effect. They give you the side effect of a particular drug. Mean a drug, a patient suffering from certain, let's suppose atrial fibrillation, right? And he take a drug that work on certain channels, right? And they give you the side effect of that drug. For example, the side effect of that drug, the patient has symptom of the hyperthyroidism after taking this drug. He has a symptom of the pulmonary
Fibrosis.
fibrosis and photodermatitis and constipation. So you have to identify the target where this drug act. Can anybody tell me which class of drug is?
Class 3, amiodarone.
Amiodarone, class C, potassium channel blocker. So USMLE love to ask the question in this way. They didn't ask in the simple way question, straightforward. So the multi-layered question, you didn't know the name of the drug, you didn't identify the diagnosis of the patient, and they asked the third thing. Understand?
Yes, but
Okay.
I have a question for the plateau phase.
Okay.
Okay, so basically, it's fair to say that the plateau phase is where potassium is now leaving and calcium is coming in, right?
Right.
That, okay. Because sometimes it can be confusing when you look at the graph, like where you see. Okay, where you have the minus 85 is red. So that red marking is the same as basically phase four, right? On the right side, you see phase four because the action potential, another action potential is going to start after like the one we're looking at
Okay,
here, right?
the simple thing I give you the pattern, how the USMLE asks the question. Clinical condition, side effect of the drug, and then mechanism of action. Right? And
Okay.
this is effective refractory period. Right? So in this period,
Yes.
there is no conduction of the action potential. So it is important, effective refractory period. So some drugs that increase or unchanged the effective refractory period. I have some pictures I will share in the next session after this session. So and some sort of quiz. You identify the drug based on this kind of the graph. Right?
Yes.
So this is action potential in SA node and AV node, right? So this lag phase one and two, right?
Yeah.
So this phase four is very important. Why this phase four is very important? Because the slope of this phase four determines the heart rate. So this slope of this phase four determines the heart rate. And this is dependent on funny current. And funny current is dependent on.
Sodium.
No, it's not simple sodium. It's dependent on sodium, potassium, and transient calcium channels, funny channels. Right? So funny
Okay.
channel, what they do? Influx of sodium, efflux of potassium, and influx, transient influx of sodium. So this is funny channel, right? So this funny channel and this flow is responsible for atomicity of art, right?
Okay.
Atomicity of the heart. Can you name the any drug that work on slow, that block the phase 4 of SA and AV node? SA and AV node, that any drug that block this phase 4 of SA and AV node action potential. Sorry?
Yeah, we can look at the calcium channel blockers.
No. Calcium channel blockers block phase 0. Mainly.
Oh, you said phase 4.
Class 3 also act on phase.
Yes, class 3 amidrol can work on can work on this channel as well. But any drug that is specifically work on these flow phase 4. The most famous drug class 2 and
beta-barrel.
Sorry?
Rituxan,
beta blocker, class 2 antiarrhythmic. So the antiarrhythmic class 2 drug that is a beta blocker block this phase 4, right?
Yes.
So if you block the phase 4, so what happens? It will decrease the conduction.
Yeah,
decrease the heart rate. So this drug is useful for many arrhythmias, particularly SVT, right?
Yes.
Okay, so this upstroke, so I have to this upstroke that is take place by due to the influx of L-type calcium channel. This is L-type and this is a T-type. So this is blocked by which drug? Which class of antiarrhythmic? Class?
Class 4.
Class 4. That is a calcium channel blocker. And can you name the calcium channel blocker that blocks the phase 0?
Verapamil.
Verapamil. These are non-dihydropyridine calcium channel blockers. Non-dihydropyridine, right?
Yes.
Okay. So, phase 4 and this is influx of calcium is important. But the difference in between that SA node and AV node action potential and difference between the atria and ventricle action potential, SA and AV node lack 1 and 2 phase. And the influx and upstroke of action potential that takes place in the SA and AV node is basically due to the influx of the calcium ion, while the upstroke of action potential that takes place in atria and ventricle is due to influx of sodium ion, right? Hello?
Yes.
Does it make some sense to you? So the high yield message, the mechanism of the antiarrhythmic drug. Does it make some sense? Do you understand the mechanism of the class, all of the four class of antiarrhythmic drugs? Right? We will discuss these drugs in detail in next session. Okay. Now I'm going to highlight some differences that in between nerve action potential and ventricular and atrial action potential, right? So this one is basically resting membrane potential. What is this? This is action potential in nerve, right?
Yes.
So this is again a high yield stuff. USML love to ask the different things in graph pattern, like what happened in this, you have to identify these things. So this resting membrane potential, at resting membrane potential, this is the permeability of potassium and this is the permeability of sodium. So at a rest, which ion cell membrane is permeable to, more permeable to which ion? Potassium or potassium ion, right? So at this point, resting membrane potential, sodium and potassium voltage gated channels are closed, right? Sodium and potassium voltage gated channel are closed at resting membrane potential. So this state, so potassium channels are closed and this activation this gates are closed, sodium voltage gated sodium channel. And the next phase is, next phase is again upstroke. Upstroke due to the which ion?
Sodium.
Sodium. So this is due to sodium influx, right?
Yes.
And why? Because this activation gate is open. This activation gate is open. So it will lead to influx of
sodium.
Of sodium ion. Right? So at the peak, at this point, what happened? Sodium gate, and more precisely, this inactivation gate is closed. So influx of the sodium is stopped at this point. Influx of sodium is stopped at this point. And what happened? It will lead to the opening of activation gate, right? Activation gate are open. Potassium activation gate are open. And when the potassium activation gate are open, it will lead to the efflux of potassium, right? This efflux of the potassium lead to repolarization. So this is repolarization, right? And this is depolarization. So why it is important, where it is applied? So this is the, they sometimes give you the depolarization. You have to identify the depolarization and which channel, which ion is responsible for sodium, which ion is responsible for this depolarization. And you have to identify sometime in the question repolarization, some sort of the experimental question. They give you the experimental type of the question and you have to identify these things on the graph. Right?
Okay.
And the last phase is, this one is hyperpolarization. Can anybody tell me why this hyperpolarization takes place? Voltage goes beyond the resting membrane potential. This is resting membrane potential, but voltage below this resting membrane potential. Why this happened?
Excessive efflux of potassium channels, because gates will open more.
Okay, so these potassium activation gates, these potassium activation gates are slow to close, faster to open and slow to close. This lead to the hyperpolarization, right?
Yes.
Okay, one more thing. Sometimes they ask about at which stage of the action potential, the maximum potassium permeability. So potassium, maximum potassium permeability at during repolarization, right?
Yes.
And maximum sodium permeability at the peak of upstroke, right?
Yes.
So this kind of the modification of this graph, some sort of the question you may face in the U world and NBME, right?
Yes.
Okay, we have to change the page. Is my screen is visible?
No.
Still not visible?
Yes, that well is going off again.
Not visible?
I mean, we can see your folder. You have documents showing in the folder, but you need to click on the document to open it.
Okay. Okay, so this is a refractory period. Can anybody tell me what is a refractory period? Refractory period. What is a refractory period?
It is a period where the fiber not respond to
Yes,
any
there is
electron
no.
potential.
Okay, there is no action potential, fiber doesn't respond to the stimulus, right? So this is absolute refractory period, and this is effective refractory period, and this is relative refractory period, right?
Yes.
So in the relative refractory period, if you give the supra threshold, the action potential may generate. But in absolute refractory period and in effective refractory period, there will be no action potential, whatever the intensity and amplitude of the stimulus. So this relative refractory period is sometimes responsible for premature contraction and arrhythmias. Right? Is my screen still visible or not? What about my screen and what about my voice?
Yeah, your voice is okay, but I think you're changing the pictures, right? Okay,
Okay.
now that's another one I saw. Yeah.
So this is for you. This is for you. Okay. Can anybody identify the A? Identify the A, please.
Okay. Yeah, that would be showing the action of class one drugs. Because
class one.
If
Yes.
you look, you
class
yes.
one drug, right? Class one antiarrhythmic. Okay, one more thing. This is class one antiarrhythmic. You are absolutely right. So, class one antiarrhythmic further divided into three types, right?
Yes,
yes.
So, class one further divided into three types, A, class 1A, class 1B, and class 1C, right? Okay, so the key thing in class 1A, this is the normal, this one, this is the normal, right? And this,
yes.
Mm-hmm. Green color that I'm highlighting, this is after the taking
drug.
The drug, right?
Yes, yes.
So this is a normal duration of action potential, right?
Yes.
So after taking, the duration of the action potential is increased, right?
Yes.
The duration of the action potential is increased and effective refractive period is also increased. So this is class 1A. Can anybody tell me the name of the class 1A drug?
Yes, you have like quinidine, procainamide.
Okay. So, yes, absolutely right. So how they ask in the exam? Again, they give you the clinical VINET. They give you some sort of the SVT, sign and symptoms, and give you the side effects. So what are the side effects of these drugs? Class 1A antiarrhythmic, side effects of the class 1A antiarrhythmic.
Well, yes, you can have drug-induced SLE. You can
yes,
also be ringing.
SLE.
Yes, ringing in the ear, which is a synchronism.
Yes.
Of course, yeah, those are the two that I'm familiar
Thrombocytopenia.
With.
No. And the most important?
Yeah, TOSAD also. Yeah.
Yes. Thrombocytopenia, increased QT interval. So, some sort of the side effect, drug-induced SLE. So, what are the labs that indicate the drug-induced SLE? Which antibody in drug-induced SLE present?
Antihistone antibodies.
Yes, very high yield. Drug-induced SLE antihistone antibodies will be present. Right?
Yes.
So the side effect, and they ask you, you have to identify the graph. Class 1A, right? Okay. So can anybody identify this B graph?
Class 1B.
Yes, class 1B,
class 1B,
yes.
Class 1B, what does do it with the action potential? Increase, decrease, remain unchanged.
No, you can see that it's increased.
No.
Also, because
this is a normal.
Yeah.
And this is after taking the drug.
Oh yeah, it decreases action potential.
Decrease action potential. Right?
Yes.
In class.
Yes.
1B. Can anybody name the class 1B drug?
Yeah, lidocaine, mexiletin.
Okay.
Also phenytoin. Phenytoin, yeah.
Can anybody tell me the any use of this class 1B drug?
The use? Yeah, post MI.
Okay. Any drug that also used for post MI? Which also has an antiarrhythmic drug. You say that class 1B is used for post-MI, right?
Yes.
Yes.
I am asking, yes, you are right, absolutely right. Any other class, any other drug that is also included in the antiarrhythmic drug that is also used for the post-MI?
Beta blocker, class 2?
Yes, beta blocker.
Okay.
So beta blocker is also used for post-MI. Right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, one more thing. So what are the side effects of the class 1B drug?
Well, 1B drug, but seizures can occur.
Okay, there is interfere with CNS, and they lead to the bradycardia, some sort of, and it, so identification on this kind of the graph is important, and their use is important, right? It used in post-MI and digoxin-induced arrhythmias. Right?
Yes.
Okay. Can anybody identify this? C. It's so simple.
One C.
Yeah, that's one C, class one C.
Okay. Give me the one name of the class one C drug.
Flecainide.
Flecainide.
Okay.
Propafenone.
Right, absolutely right. So, class 1C, what does they do, the action potential duration? Increase, decrease, remain unchanged.
Action potential duration.
Action potential is this.
Action potential duration.
Okay, it has a minimal effect, right?
Yes.
This is after drug, and this is this is before drug. So it is a minimal effect on action potential duration, right?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay. But it will increase the QRS duration. It will increase the QRS duration, right?
Yes. Yes.
Okay.
Now, quick question.
Quick question.
So, yes. So, the increase in the QRS will be based because of the depression of the slope, right? The sodium upshoot.
Yes, basically anything that interferes this, they will increase the QRS duration. Okay. What are the uses of this class 1C drug?
Supraventricular tachycardia.
Absolutely. Supraventricular tachycardia. The contraindication of this class 1C drug is very important. Can anybody tell me the what are the contraindication of
class 1?
Ischemic or structural defect in the heart.
Okay. Okay. So, can anybody tell me which class, which subtype of class 1A is more potent?
1C.
1C, right? So,
yes.
This is again, sometimes they give you, they are asked about the which drug is more potent, right? Which drug is more potent? So it is
strong sodium channel blockade.
Yes. So class 1A, in class 1A, they have simply asked the question which drug is more potent. So class 1C is more potent than class 1B, and 1B is more potent than class. So is a like
one C more potent than 1A and then 1B. It's the least
1A
potent.
And 1A more than
1B.
1B. So as fast taxi cab. It is a mnemonic that I already mentioned in the first page. Okay. 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 So which drug is this? Which drug is this? So, this is normal. This is normal. SA node or AV node. This is normal.
Beta and blocker this, plus two.
Beta blocker. And this is after taking drug. So, this is basically beta blocker. Beta blocker class 2, right? So what does they do? They interfere with the, this is phase 4, right? This is phase 4 of SA or AV node, right? So what are the important use of class 2 antiarrhythmic? What are the important uses of class 2 antiarrhythmic? SVT.
Two type of arrhythmia. SVT, atrial flutter fibrillation.
And post MI, right? So post MI, another drug is used that we already discussed is
1B.
1B. So 1B is best for post MI, right? So can anybody tell me about the side effect of this drug or this class two antiarrhythmic?
We can precipitate asthma.
Yes, it can
Heartbreak.
precipitate
Yeah.
asthma. Through which
Yeah,
receptor
heart
blocking?
block.
Through blocking which receptor? It precipitate asthma through which
B
blocking?
beta 2.
Okay.
Yeah. It'll also mask, show for a
Absolutely.
hypoglycemia.
Absolutely right.
Can cause bradycardia. It can cause AV block.
Okay, one more question. If the patient, how will you treat? How will you treat the beta blocker overdose?
Glucagon.
Glucagon.
Okay, glucagon.
Or you can give atropine
Yes,
or
you can
saline.
atropine saline. Okay. So if you are decreasing the conduction velocity at the AV node, what will change in the ECG? If you are prolonged repolarization means decreasing the conduction velocity, right? So what change you will expect in the ECG?
Heart block.
Heart block, increase PR interval, right? So it's simply you can say heart block, increase in PR interval, right? Okay, can you tell me the any other physiological thing that interfered with this phase four? Phase four.
Vagal
Acetylcholine,
stimulation.
parasympathetic stimulation. Okay. Can anybody tell me the receptor that present on SA node that are stimulated by acetylcholine?
M2.
M2. Right? Okay, sometimes they ask, these are important stuff. Okay, so this is, I think, is the last one. Okay, and can anybody identify this antiarrhythmic drug?
Class 2
Potassium
potassium
channel.
channel blocker.
Gotcha.
This is potassium
Potassium.
channel. Okay, so the potassium channel blocker, which class?
Class 3.
Class 3. Trust me, this is a so high yield class antiarrhythmic drugs mechanism and these kind of the graph. If you understand, this is very useful. Trust me. Okay, so this is class 3 antiarrhythmic. Okay, any two drugs that included in the class 3 antiarrhythmic.
Miodaron, dofetilide,
Absolutely right.
Prokalo,
Okay, so
Prokalo, Prokalo.
the most important class 3 antiarrhythmic is amiodarone, right?
Because it is also given for thyroid treatment.
So yes, it interfere with thyroid. Absolutely right. So it may lead to hypo or hyperthyroidism.
Hypothyroidism.
Okay. So sometimes they ask you, they give you the graph and the question, and they want to know about which test are you advised before starting this antiarrhythmic drug.
thyroid function, pulmonary
Absolutely right.
function, liver function test.
Thyroid function, right? Thyroid function test. Because it may lead to the hyperthyroidism.
Yes, the Wolff-Chakoff effect.
Pulmonary function test. Anything else?
Liver function.
Liver function, because it is hepatotoxic. So always advise before starting the amiodarone, pulmonary function test, liver function test, and thyroid function test. Okay. Does it have more any other side effects? Amiodarone.
Vision problem.
Vision problem due to the deposit
in the cornea. Yeah.
Yes. And what about the skin manifestation?
Yeah, blue gray color.
Blue gray skin deposited, resulting in photodermatitis. Okay. It may lead to the constipation and many more side effects. That is not important. The important side effect is pulmonary fibrosis. That's why we advise pulmonary function test. Hepatotoxicity, that's why we advise a liver function test. Hyperthyroidism, that's why we advise thyroid function test. So this is a sometimes straightforward question. You have to justify why we advise these kind of the investigation, right? Okay. What does it do with action potential duration? Increase or decrease?
Increase.
The action potential duration is increase.
Increase.
Okay. And effective refractory period is also increased. Okay. So can you tell me the name of class of antiarrhythmic that prolong QT interval?
It is 1A and class 3.
1A and class 3. Absolutely right. Okay, did we done the calcium channel blocker?
No.
Okay. So this is the gain. This is calcium channel blocker, right? So this is a calcium channel blocker. So calcium channel blocker, non-dihydropyridine. Calcium channel blocker are two types, dihydropyridine and non-dihydropyridine. So dihydropyridine calcium channel blocker, they are more effect on the vessels. And this non-dihydropyridine, More effect on heart.
Cardiac heart.
Okay. So again, you already know the name of these. This is class 4 antiarrhythmic. So this is a class 4 antiarrhythmic. Right? So verapamil is the most important example. So this is normal. This is normal. So the slope of action potential is decrease. And which ion is responsible for this slope? Can anybody tell me?
Sodium.
Calcium.
Calcium. This
calcium,
is SA or AV node. So you made a lot of mistakes. So the calcium influx is responsible. Which calcium channel? L type or T type?
L type.
Sorry?
L.
L type.
L type. So this kind of the question. L type, right?
Yeah.
So again, you are prolong the repolarization at AV node. If you prolong the repolarization, what will happen to conduction velocity? It will decrease or increase?
Decreased.
So the conduction velocity is decreased. Decreased conduction velocity. What finding you will find on ECG?
Prolonged
What finding?
BR interval.
Sorry?
Prolonged BR interval.
Yes, prolonged PR interval. Beta blocker also prolonged PR interval, right?
Okay.
So, what are the uses of this drug?
Yeah, we can use it for arrhythmia control.
Hypertension.
Yes. So the side effect of this drug is a most high yield thing. Side effect of the calcium channel blocker. Okay. Can anybody tell me the
constipation,
headache,
edema.
Yes, constipation.
Peripheral edema.
Edema.
Yes.
Flushing. So these are the some of the high yield regarding the graph. These kind of graph are super high yield and the side effect of these drugs. You have to identify these kind of the drugs based on the side effect and based on these graphs. Right?
Yes.
Okay, one more thing. Today, last
I have
thing.
A doubt. Hello? Hello?
Yes,
sir,
I can
have a
hear.
Doubt.
Sorry?
I have a doubt. How will we differentiate between beta blocker and calcium channel blocker from the graph? It's quite confusing.
Okay, wait. I will. Okay. This is graph of
This is
calcium channel, or so they are mainly act on this upstroke, right?
Okay,
upstroke, and the beta blocker mainly work on phase 4, right?
Yeah,
does it make some sense to you?
Yes. Thank you.
Today, last graph, last picture, and then we will conclude this session. Okay. So, this is last picture of the today session. So, these are some differences. These are some differences related to skeletal muscle contraction. So this is a mechanism during the skeletal muscle, right? Skeletal muscle.
Okay.
So what happens? This is action potential comes, right? And this action potential causes entry of the calcium, and this entry of the calcium causes release of acetylcholine. Acetylcholine release, and it will bind on the acetylcholine receptor on the postsynaptic membrane, right? Right?
Yes.
So,
yes.
In this way, the action potential is transferred from nerve to the skeletal muscle. But what happens in cardiac action potential? Calcium is released during action potential. So, in cardiac action potential, calcium induced calcium release, right? So in skeletal muscle, there is no calcium. Calcium is released during action potential in the skeletal muscle, but in cardiac calcium is released during the plateau phase, right? So this is that's some sort of the difference, and there is no plateau phase in skeletal muscle contraction. And cardiac myocytes are electrically coupled through which junction?
Gap junction.
Gap junction. So this gap junction are responsible for syncytium of cardiac myocytes. Right? So the cardiac muscle action potential mainly due to sodium and calcium involvement, while the skeletal or nerve action potential is mainly due to the sodium ion, right?
Okay.